Recorded Books and RB Digital present Shoot Like a Girl, One Woman's Dramatic Fight in Afghanistan and on the Home Front by Mary Jennings Hegar, narrated by Cynthia Farrell. This book begins with a note from the author. It has been incredibly difficult to recount some of the events in this book. Many of them are hard enough to talk about with a close friend, let alone write about for anyone and everyone to read. I'm putting it all out there for the world to see, and it's terrifying. But many people don't know what Air Force rescue does, or that the Air Force even has helicopters. Many people don't know about the enormous contribution of the Air National Guard. Many don't think that there are women serving in combat roles. Others think that the women who do serve in combat shrink in fear when the bullets fly. I know differently, and I wanted you to know, too. That said, there are security concerns associated with sharing the real names of some individuals still serving. On a couple of occasions, there are some who are perhaps not painted in the best light. For these reasons, some of the names have been changed. None of the stories have been dramatized, and the Department of Defense has redacted a few key names and words. All of the accounts have been scrutinized by the Department of Defense for classified information, and they are relayed here exactly as I remember them. Most of these stories have been vetted by others who were there to ensure accuracy, but people do tend to remember some of the details differently. There were heroic feats of valor and questionable decisions throughout, but for the most part, we all did the best we could with the information we had in the fog of war. Without Monday morning quarterbacking, what follows is my best attempt to tell our story as seen through my eyes and validated by my comrades in arms. From the poem play Hassan by James Elroy Flecker. Go as a pilgrim and seek out danger, far from the comfort and the well-lit avenues of life. Pit your every soul against the unknown and seek stimulation in the comfort of the brave. Experience cold, hunger, heat, and thirst, and survive to see another challenge and another dawn. Only then will you be at peace with yourself and be able to know and to say, I look down the farthest side of the mountain, fulfilled and understanding all, and truly content that I lived a full life and one that was my own choice. Prologue. I glanced out the window at the dark shadows of sharks just under the surface of the sea. Shaking my head, I willed myself to focus on the task at hand as I continued running through the checklist, checking my equipment, reviewing where the emergency release was on the door, miming unbuckling the seat harness and unplugging my comm cord, checking to make sure that the tiny oxygen bottle on my vest was charged and on. The bottle would provide about 30 seconds of air if we found ourselves plummeting to the bottom of the ocean. I was well aware of what to expect if we should have to ditch, as I had attended the thorough dunker training in Alabama, where you were strapped into a mock helicopter, shaken, plummeted into a pool, and flipped upside down. But out here in the ocean, there were no instructors standing ready to save you if you went under. There were no sharks in dunker training. My summer had been filled with exciting missions, putting out wildfires in California, marijuana eradication from the vast national forests out west, and deploying to Texas for hurricane support. But my least favorite kind of mission would be the grand finale to that exhausting summer, a long-range overwater rescue mission. A fisherman on a freighter way out in the middle of the Pacific had been injured, so my crew and I had been dispatched to go pick him up and bring him to safety. Years earlier, during my first assignment in the Air Force, I remember clearly sitting in a movie theater watching The Perfect Storm when the film came out. I had cringed, barely able to watch, as the crew on the rescue helicopter realized they were unable to refuel off of their airborne tanker to make it to dry land. When they ditched into the ocean, I thought to myself, phew, I really want to be a pilot, but I'll never put myself in that situation. You'd have to be crazy to fly a helicopter out into the middle of the ocean. Yet, 8 years later, there I was, flying the same exact helicopter I had seen in the movie, out over the open ocean, unable to refuel, and looking for a shark-free place to ditch. Just my luck. During the first days of October 2008, we had arrived in San Diego to pre-position for the mission. In other words, stage for the long flight out to the boat. It was over a 10-hour flight there and back, so we'd have to aerial refuel off the back of a C-130 four times just to make it there and home. It would be the longest flight of my career, and I knew it would test my nerves and my bladder to extremes. This was my first mission all the way out into the middle of the ocean, but every overwater flight made me a little nervous. This was my job, though, so I shook off my nerves and helped my crew prepare for the flight. We launched out of San Diego in the morning, but we packed our night vision goggles for the trip home. According to our mission planning session the night before, we knew that we'd be hitting the tanker for the fourth time after nightfall. We packed some sandwiches and water for the trip, but I wondered if I'd even be able to eat, given the situation. Plus, I knew I'd need to nearly dehydrate myself to avoid having to tackle the complicated dance of trying to urinate in the helicopter. The guys just needed to keep an empty bottle handy. But for me, there would be a bit more work involved. The blanket of clouds overhead kept our altitude to a few hundred feet above water, but the weather report assured us that the ceiling would break up as we got farther from land, which was good news. Clear skies would ensure that we would be able to climb up to refuel off the back of the C-130 aircraft that would be accompanying us. As we went feet wet, which means crossing the coastline for the open ocean and waving goodbye to land, we stepped through our appropriate checklists. These checklists were innocuous enough, but they only added to my anxiety. For whatever reason, having to ditch into the ocean, perfect storm style, represented my greatest fear of all of the possible contingencies we could face as a combat search and rescue platform, and it was a fear I had to overcome each and every time I went feet wet. Whether it was a training mission over a lake or a real-world water rescue, I always had to make myself take a deep breath as I stepped through the motions of the overwater checklist. I knew I wasn't alone in this fear, but the rest of my crew seemed much more unhappy about the four aerial refuels we had scheduled during this flight. To tell you the truth, as nerve-wracking as it could be, aerial refueling is my absolute favorite thing to do. The goal is to aim the tip of the refueling probe into the basket at the end of the C-130's hose. The probe is a metal tube that extends out from the right lower front of the aircraft, about 8 feet past the edge of the rotor disc. The hose looks like a fireman's hose with a round metal cage about 18 inches across that has a stabilizing sort of parachute attached around it. When we practice refueling, we follow the same steps each and every time. First, we hold a steady course while we talk to the C-130 on the radio. They would execute a rendezvous by slowing down and creeping up behind and above us. We would answer by increasing power to climb and speed up. This was usually relatively easy when we did it in real world, as we'd be light due to being on empty. It was a little more difficult when we would practice it if we were already full of fuel. Practicing this single engine, meaning with the power limited as if you had lost an engine, was also a lot of fun, though. You'd need the C-130 to fly beneath you instead of above, and you'd dive down to the hose, trying to aim your refueling probe directly into the basket on the hose. You'd only get one shot at this, because technically, in real-world situations, you wouldn't ever have the power to catch up and try again. One and done, basically, so you tried pretty hard not to miss. On our flight that day out to the boat's location, we hit the tanker to refuel about 3 hours into the trip. Then, 3 hours later, I took the controls for the second rendezvous with the C-130. It can be physically and mentally taxing to constantly have to refuel the helicopter, so the pilots generally take turns. As I settled in with the controls, Finn, the other pilot, chatted with the tanker on the radio, and the flight engineer, or FE, called out that he had the C-130 in sight above and behind us.
"Start your climb," he said.
I gently pulled up on the collective, giving the aircraft more power, and dipped the nose slightly forward to maintain our speed. As per my usual habit, I took a deep breath and wiggled my fingers and toes to release any tension. I've always found that the worst thing you can do on a finesse maneuver like this is to grip the controls too tightly. As I climbed, I glanced over and above my shoulder every few seconds until the C-130 came into view.
"Okay, he's coming up on your right,"
the FE called out, tracking the tanker in tenth of a mile increments.
"Half mile out. 0.4, 0.3, 0.2. You should see him."
I looked up through the greenhouse, our nickname for the window in the roof.
"Got him. Coming up and right,"
I announced, my eyes glued to the tanker. I took the formation position behind and to the left of the bird, and they extended their hose. We ran the refueling checklist, and I maneuvered into position directly behind the basket. At this point, you are flying in a tight formation very close to the other aircraft, so close that we sometimes signal with lights or use hand signals to communicate from our windows to theirs. This is the moment when, as a pilot, you feel very much in control. But the crew members in the back of the plane, the so-called back-enders, tend to get pretty quiet at this point in the maneuver. I settled in behind the hose and took another deep breath, singing quietly to myself off intercom, as I always did, before I started to make a run. Slowly increasing power and pushing the nose over slightly, I hit the basket dead center with enough force to connect. Then I continued up and to the left until I was in the refuel position and the fuel started flowing.
"Damn, MJ, I never want to refuel with another pilot again," the gunner said.
I smiled a thank you. It was always a relief to everyone when we got the refuel over with. We had another 3 hours of gas on board now and could relax for a bit. Refueling was a harrowing experience for the crew members in the back, as they had no control over the sometimes bumpy aircraft flailing about, trying to plug within 24 or so feet from the tanker at about 120 miles per hour. Some pilots would try to force it, making jerky corrections at the last minute or overcorrecting. Singing quietly always kept me from overthinking things and putting too much pressure on myself. It worked like a charm every time. Whenever we flew a rescue mission over open ocean, I'd be blown away when the boat we were looking for eventually materialized out of the vast blue expanse of the ocean. It took my breath away every time. Nothing but deep, dark ocean for hours upon hours. And then, suddenly, our target appeared out of nowhere. It somehow felt like dumb luck every time. The C-130 we had refueled from was on scene to support us and was circling overhead. They had already dropped their pararescue jumpers, also known as PJs, who had to parachute down to the boat to stabilize the patient. We got on scene right after our sister ship had picked up the patient and two of the PJs. When they were clear, we hovered in close to the ship to pick up the remaining two PJs with our hoist for the long trip back to land. Now all we had to do was fly home. With the end of this long mission in sight, we climbed up to execute our third refueling rendezvous. Out in the middle of the vast blue ocean, the sun was just starting to set. Pretty soon we'd be on night vision goggles, which would make our fourth refueling a real challenge. We executed the rendezvous and connected to the hose without a problem, but when we began the refuel checklist, the flight engineer noticed that the gas wasn't transferring. No big deal. That could be any one of a million different issues. Finn, who was flying at the time, gently jiggled the controls, trying to get whatever valve was stuck to unstick. Nothing. I flipped some switches back and forth. Still nothing. Finn decided to disconnect and try again. Nada. We crossed over and tried the other hose. No gas. Not good. We disconnected again, floated back to the observation position, and started to discuss our options. Finn ran through the checklists and some troubleshooting options with the FE, trying everything we could think of. Then we plugged again and still couldn't get any gas. As our fuel gauge ticked down closer to zero, the cold reality began to sink in. My greatest fear was materializing before me. We were going to have to ditch the bird in the middle of the freezing ocean just before nightfall. I kept my toughest poker face on, but all I could think about was the helicopter that had ditched during the perfect storm and the brave men on board, not all of whom survived that mission. I listened wordlessly, desperately hoping we could find another solution. Finn, who was a more senior pilot than I, started talking about our strategy. We would try to get back closer to the boat, and he would hover over the water while we all jumped out. Finn also thought he could possibly lower us to the ship if we had time. He would then offset away from us and put the helicopter down in the water before egressing and trying to escape the sinking aircraft by himself. I started thanking the universe that we had PJs on board. We all checked our equipment and looked around at each other uneasily. Okay, so that's the plan. Anyone have any better ideas before I brief the tanker on it? Finn asked. His question was met with silence for several seconds. None of us liked the plan, I can guarantee it, but we didn't have any better suggestions. We glanced around nervously at one another, all of us racking our brains for any other ideas that might not be by the book. Then the FE piped up.
Hey, why don't you try going zero G for a sec? Maybe the gas we have left will hit the top of the tank and shake something loose.
We looked around. It sounded a little crazy, but might it work? At this point, we were ready to try anything, absolutely anything, to avoid ditching out in the dark, cold abyss below us. We nodded at one another, and Finn started a sharp climb. At the crest, he dumped the collective to reduce power significantly and nosed the bird over. We all floated, held down only by our seat harnesses, as unsecured gear flew everywhere. The recovery at the bottom of the maneuver made the pit of my already uneasy stomach drop, but we leveled out without incident. The extra time we had taken pulling this maneuver would definitely put us in a bind if we ended up having to ditch, but we knew it was at least worth a shot. It was time to hit the tanker one more time to see if it had worked. I think we were all holding our breath. We hit the basket on the first try and climbed up to the refueling position. The C-130 was already aware of the issues we were having due to our multiple plugs, so there were a lot of eager faces looking at us from the window of the cargo door. I flipped the switch to begin the fuel transfer, and we all stared at the gauge. A quiet moment ticked by. Nothing. Then the needle quivered and started to move.
Fuel flow established! I exclaimed to huge cheers. I keyed the mic and relayed the good news to the tanker. I could hear the relief in their voices as they went from possibly being our overhead search support back to just being our tanker. I drew a shaky breath and started to laugh, listening to my crew doing the same. Maintenance would never figure out what had happened, but I knew I had my FE to thank for keeping us out of the drink. His suggestion to try the unorthodox maneuver was due to his deep knowledge of the system, not because he had read the suggestion in some checklist. That mission wouldn't be the last time that a flight engineer's vast systems knowledge would likely save my life. We hit the tanker for the fourth time on night vision goggles without any issues, and the mood on board lightened. As we came in to land at the airfield in San Diego that night,
The runway and taxi lights beneath us made it seem as if we were descending down upon a blanket of stars. We were all aware of what had nearly happened, and the jokes we were throwing back and forth as we approached the airfield were tinged with an undercurrent of almost wild relief. As we descended, my happiness began to dissipate. Man, I needed to pee. Chapter 1. When I looked up into the stands and saw my parents, my dad waved at me as if to say, "Only 75 more minutes, right?" I flicked a glance across the field at my teammates hammering our opponent at the far end. When you're the goalie on a top-ranked high school soccer team, you learn to expect not to see much action. It was a beautiful autumn Texas day, and the sky overhead was a deep, dark blue. I heard a rumble in the distance, but there wasn't a cloud in the sky, so I knew it had to be one of the F-16s flying out from Bergstrom Air Force Base in Austin. I craned my neck upward to catch a glimpse of the beautiful bird. There it was. My eyes traced its arcing path across the sky. It was so beautiful, I couldn't tear my eyes away. Thump. The ball bounced off of my forehead, and immediately, two important things happened. One, I became the second-string goalie, and two, I learned an important lesson about staying focused on the task at hand. It was important to have dreams, but if all you did was envy those who were living out your dreams, you would never manage to achieve them yourself. Dream big. Then force yourself back down to earth to keep plugging away at the minutiae that will bring those dreams within reach. After the game, my dad ruffled my hair as we walked to the car. "Don't sweat it, sweet pea," he said softly in his heavy Alabama drawl. "At least they didn't score on you. You've already lettered in tennis, anyway." His words were sweet, as always, but they did little to assuage my humiliation. My dad stood only about 5 inches above my 5'4" frame, but he was thick through the arms, chest, and stomach. His full head of salt and pepper hair was always combed back neatly, and he was rarely without a bushy mustache. He was sort of a George Clooney meets Burt Reynolds meets Foghorn Leghorn type, and I loved him with all of my heart. David wasn't my biological father, but he had raised me since I was about 10. My real dad, an abusive, racist jerk, was long gone by then, thank goodness. After a terrifying marriage to my biological father, my mom had found her prince charming in a gassy cowboy who could laugh until his face was red and he couldn't breathe. My stepfather was the one who showed me what real love was. I wasn't his child, but he loved me just the same, not because he had to, but because he wanted to. Everyone in my family knew my dream was to become a fighter pilot, which was something I'd been talking about ever since I was a little girl. I knew it the first time I saw Star Wars. I wanted to be Han Solo, flying the Millennium Falcon through an asteroid field. David, a Vietnam vet, taught me what it meant to serve my country, and he did not distinguish between men and women on that topic. He never once discouraged my ambitions by telling me girls couldn't fly jets in combat, even though at the time no woman had ever done so.
"Sweet pea, if you want to do it, I'm sure you'll do it," he always told me.
David taught me that the warrior spirit wasn't only for men. He never said it in so many words. He just treated me the same as his own son, my stepbrother Jeremy. He never said that I was strong for a girl or the bravest woman he'd met. I was always just strong or brave to him. Becoming a pilot wouldn't be tough for a woman. It would be a great challenge to undertake, and he'd be proud of me just for trying. That was David. He had my back, no matter what, until suddenly, he didn't anymore. My first memory as a 4-year-old little girl was seeing my biological father push my mother through a plate glass door. My 10-year-old sister, trying to protect our mother, hit him in the back to stop him from going after her, and I sat on the fireplace and watched helplessly as he chased her around the circular ground floor of our tiny two-story house in Fairfield, Connecticut. Elaine darted under the archway to the dining room, around the table and chairs, and through the swinging door to the kitchen with him hot on her heels. She made it around at least once before he caught her by her hair. My father had my sister by the throat, a foot off the ground against the wall in the dining room, while my mother screamed that he was hurting her and to let her go. I hugged my legs tight, arms around my knees, with my eyes closed, trying as hard as I could to pretend this wasn't happening, that this wasn't my life. I don't know if it was at that moment or sometime later, but I knew I would never, ever find myself trapped like that again. Weak, unable to protect those I love from evil. But that was definitely the moment I figured out what feeling I hate most in the world. Fear. My mother, Grace, grew up in Jacksonville, Florida, in an incredibly abusive home herself. I suppose that is why she put up with the treatment she received from my biological father for so long. She didn't know any different. She came to feel as if she deserved the abuse for some reason, and to this day, she is always quick to believe the worst about herself. At 17 years old, my mother had hoped my father was rescuing her from her violent upbringing. But instead, she found herself right back in the nightmare she was so familiar with. Her children were the only thing that made her happy, and my sister and I were the center of her world. Elaine and I were just over 5 years apart, but we grew up in two very different worlds. Despite our father's violent outbursts, Elaine was still a daddy's girl, whereas I was closer to my mom. This enormous difference in our personalities continues to drive a wedge between us to this day. Our worldviews are completely different. I feel like I was the lucky one. I was 7 years old by the time my mother finally got us out, but my sister was already 14. I credit a lot of my life's success to my mother's courage in getting us away from my biological father. Honestly, though, it wasn't until he cheated on her and left her for a short time that my mother finally managed to escape the monster. And although I was only 7, she confided in me when my father had called her, trying to convince her to come back to him. He told her that he wanted her to bring my sister and me back to live with him so that we could all be together, that he would put blankets over our heads before shooting us with his shotgun and then would turn it on himself. We could finally be a happy family together, in heaven. We got on a plane to Texas soon after that phone call. My teenage sister gave my mother a hard time about leaving all her friends, but if my mom had gone back to him, I wouldn't be the person I am today. More likely, I'd be dead, or at least in jail for finally giving my father what he deserved. Every once in a while, when someone calls me brave, I think, hell, flying helicopters under fire in Afghanistan is nowhere near as scary as the thought of being that little girl again. By the time I got hit in the head with that soccer ball, I had already decided I would become a combat pilot. But at the age of 16, I had no idea how complicated the path I'd end up taking would be. I did know that if I wanted to achieve my goal, I had to be the cream of the crop. So I set out to be the absolute best at everything I did. Over the coming years, I would end up playing tennis, soccer, volleyball, basketball, and track, while also participating in cheerleading and marching band. The band at our high school was a pretty big deal, always competing for the top state honors, and despite that one low point as a soccer goalie, I always enjoyed competing, working hard and playing hard. As it turned out, one of my most momentous decisions in high school came early, at the beginning of my freshman year, when I decided to run for class president. After I won, I was thrilled to get a chance to develop a wonderful relationship with our class sponsor, a Navy man, Mr. Dewey. Mr. Dewey was a big early supporter of my dreams, echoing the things my parents had always told me about my natural leadership abilities and my courage. He became my mentor and my guide throughout the rest of my high school years. When it came time to obtain letters of recommendation for college my senior fall, I naturally sought out Mr. Dewey. As a veteran, I knew he'd be proud of me for applying for an ROTC scholarship. I had never mentioned my dream of being a military pilot to him, and given his experience, I was looking forward to his insight. A few days after I'd made the request, I stopped by his classroom to pick up the letter. Mr. Dewey, with his thinning, combed-over hair and a rotund belly, was sitting behind his desk, sealing an envelope when I walked in. "Hey, Mr. Dewey," I called out cheerfully. No response. He was usually so friendly and kind, but that day, Mr. Dewey didn't even look up at me as he handed me that sealed envelope.
"Here, good luck," he barked.
Then he picked up his pen and started making notes on some papers in front of him. I was clearly being dismissed. Something must be wrong with him, I thought. Perhaps someone in his family was sick? Thanks. I can't tell you how much I appreciate it. I almost asked him if he was okay, but when he abruptly turned away from me, I decided he wanted to be alone. I hesitantly left, concerned about whatever he must be going through. As I walked down the empty hallway between rows of quiet lockers, I looked down at the envelope I held in my hand. It was only then that I started becoming suspicious. Why did he choose to seal it rather than let me read it? I wondered. We had always had such an open relationship. It seemed strange. I studied the letter intently, trying to see if I could read any of it through the envelope. I couldn't read any actual words, but I could tell that he had failed to sign the form that accompanied the letter. Since I knew I couldn't submit the letter unsigned, I decided to take that as justification to open the envelope. What I found inside blew my mind. Mr. Dewey's recommendation was anything but. Instead, it was a scathing description of my lack of leadership ability, discipline, and drive. The exact opposite of what he had told me time and again over the past few years. Now, I've never been the type to burst into tears, but losing my temper? That was something I often had trouble controlling. I didn't even think twice about turning on my heel and storming down the hall to his classroom to demand an explanation of why he would lie about me on one of the most important letters of my life. Without a single thought about the potential backlash, I threw open his door, startling him as he sat there, still grading papers at his desk. The door slammed into the door jamb as I burst into the room, holding up the opened letter. "What the hell, Mr. Dewey?" My fury immediately melted into despair when I saw the look in his eyes. Instead of the guilt or shame I expected, since he had just been caught doing something underhanded and dishonest, he was looking at me with utter disgust.
"Watch your language, young lady. How dare you open that?"
He sneered at me.
"What's the name of your recruiter? I'm going to call him and let him know what you've done."
"How dare I? Are you kidding me? Is this how you really feel about me?" I managed to sputter out, crushed by the betrayal. His expression softened slightly, but the disdain remained.
"The Navy is no place for you, Mary. What are you trying to prove? This isn't a game. Defending our nation should be left to the strong, and it's no place for a woman," he said, shaking his head firmly. "You can still do great things. Maybe one day you'll be the CEO of your own company. Trust me, you'll thank me one day."
For once in my life, no witty retort rolled off my tongue. I was in shock. Years later, I'd look back at this and see it for the example it was. Mr. Dewey was simply the first of many people I would soon meet, a faction of American citizens who truly believed they had to protect me and protect our nation's military from harm by denying me the opportunity to serve. At that moment, however, in my first ever experience with discrimination, I was devastated, in disbelief. I quietly turned and left his classroom. I had developed a strong relationship with my recruiter over the last year, as I'd been navigating the process of trying to join the Navy, so I immediately called him from a payphone in the cafeteria. My hands were shaking as I dropped the change into the phone. Now that the anger had passed, I could feel my eyes begin to well up with unshed tears. I braced my fingers on the side of the phone, trying to hold my hand steady enough to dial his number. When I related the story to him, he was silent. Then I heard him draw a slow breath. MJ, I'm going to be honest with you. You might as well get used to this, he said. Mr. Dewey might be the first, he told me, but he would most certainly not be the last person to try to stop me. I grew up that day. The path ahead of me wouldn't be an easy one. Good. I never liked things easy. Despite this speed bump, I was happy to be accepted into the University of Texas at Austin. Now that I was slightly jaded about the Navy after my experience with Mr. Dewey, I joined Air Force ROTC instead. It was so exciting to be in a group of 150 kids who were all just a little bit like me. We all got made fun of in high school for not smoking pot. We all secretly thought we were Maverick from Top Gun, and we all wanted to serve our country. I knew I had found my home. While I attended regular classes, just like all the other UT Austin students, I was consumed with all things Air Force. In my biology class, I would write in tiny print in the corner of my notes the entire code of conduct. I can recite it word for word to this day. Article 1. I am an American, fighting in the forces which guard my country and our way of life. I am prepared to give my life in their defense. Article 2. I will never surrender of my own free will. If in command, I will never surrender the members of my command while they still have the means to resist. Article 3. If I am captured, I will continue to resist by all means available. I will make every effort to escape and aid others to escape. I will accept neither parole nor special favors from the enemy. Article 4. If I become a prisoner of war, I will keep faith with my fellow prisoners. I will give no information or take part in any action which may be harmful to my comrades. If I am senior, I will take command. If not, I will obey the lawful orders of those appointed over me and will back them up in every way. Article 5. When questioned, should I become a prisoner of war, I am required to give name, rank, serial number, and date of birth. I will evade answering further questions to the utmost of my ability. I will make no oral or written statements disloyal to my country and its allies or harmful to their cause. Article 6. I will never forget that I am an American, fighting for freedom, responsible for my actions, and dedicated to the principles which made my country free. I will trust in my God and the United States of America. I quickly became an expert on everything that had to do with drill and ceremonies. The drum corps-like formations and marching was like a choreographed dance, one that reminded me of my experience with the marching band in high school. I loved being a part of something so much bigger than myself. It was 1995, and although the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq were many years ahead, I was always mentally preparing for the eventuality that we'd be involved in another conflict. I knew that I wanted to be a pilot, and the most important thing to me was to live my life in a way that ensured I'd serve with honor. I wanted to make my parents proud of me, to save the person beside me if I could, and to make some sort of lasting impact on the world. I immediately set my sights on pledging an ROTC organization called the Arnold Air Society, AAS, which was sort of like a military fraternity and clearly boasted the top cadets. Although there was only one other female in the group, I knew I could hack it. Between the hazing, which could get intense, and the endless grilling of the cadets on military general knowledge, completing the process was pretty overwhelming, and my GPA suffered for it. But surviving the 8-week pledge process and being welcomed into the AAS was my greatest accomplishment to date. The semester I pledged AAS was the first time in my life I truly felt I'd proved to myself just how tough I could be. In the years to come, I'd face many challenges. That semester gave me the mentality that if I could survive those hellish months, I could make it through just about anything. After that, my second year of college was an absolute breeze. In the summer of 1997, after completing my sophomore year, I went off to field training, which was essentially boot camp for Air Force officer candidates. And yes, I know this is going to sound strange, but field training was pretty much my version of Disneyland. Field training is similar to enlisted boot camp, but it is shorter and is more focused on leadership rather than the brutal breaking down and building up of troops like you see in the movies. This was a rite of passage and a requirement for all cadets after their second year. It was only offered in the summer, but I was more than happy to leave the sweltering Texas weather behind and head to New England. In June of that year, I shipped off to Dover Air Force Base. Upon arrival, the hundreds of cadets were split up into flights, and each flight had a couple dozen people assigned to them. We bunked in barracks that always had to be inspection ready, and we were woken up before dawn every day by reveille and the even louder military training instructors, MTIs. There were plenty of tough moments in field training, but honestly, I think meals were the worst part for me. I'm a slow eater in general, so I had a harder time than others basically scraping my entire tray into my mouth in fewer than 7 minutes. You also had to get at least a couple of glasses of water down in that time, and you weren't dismissed until the water was gone. At the end of each day, we were all utterly spent from being physically and mentally challenged every waking minute. So it was a sweet relief to fall into our rock-hard beds every night to the gentle, comforting sounds of taps playing in the background. For most people, this was torture. But some of us felt right at home. Several days into the training, we were finally sent out on the obstacle course. I could barely contain my excitement. I'd been looking forward to this since our arrival. None of us knew what the course would look like before we arrived, but we probably all had pictured the worst. I was relieved to see that the first few obstacles were challenging but easy enough. We would have to low crawl under barbed wire, jump over logs, and clamber up cargo nets. I was like a kid in a candy shop. Finally, I felt like I was in the real military. I coasted through the first three obstacles, but then I was met with a surprise at the fourth. The obstacle looked like a huge ladder built by a drunken giant. The rungs were 2x6 pieces of wood nailed to telephone poles at slight angles. It looked intimidating, but awesome, and I couldn't wait for my turn. But as we lined up in front of it, the drill instructors shocked us with the news that the women wouldn't have to complete this particular obstacle. I shook my head in fury and immediately stepped to the front of the line. There was no force on earth that could have stopped me from getting over that obstacle. I walked toward it, eyes narrowed, utterly focused. It was easy at first. You just stood on one board, leaned your hips against another board, and reached up to grab the third. Pushing down with one hand on the board at your hip, you would haul yourself up by holding on to the high board while lifting your legs up to the hip-level board. As you neared the top, however, the boards started getting farther and farther apart. My 5'4" frame wasn't ideal for the task, and by the time I got to the second-to-last board, I could no longer stand on one board and reach the last board at the top. I paused for a moment and thought. I'd have to jump, hoping I wouldn't miss grabbing onto that high board. It was the only way. So I jumped. I didn't miss. I grabbed hold of the topmost board and used it to get my legs over the hip-height board. Finally, I could pull myself over the top, swinging my leg up over the last board. Then I sat for just a moment to take in the view. It was beautiful. The 30 or so other cadets assigned to my flight were all going crazy 25 feet below me. The surprise drill instructor, ignoring the raucous cheers, was looking up at me as if to say, "What the fuck are you doing? Get the fuck down here." I laughed and flipped over onto my stomach to start making my way back down to the bottom. The way down was still scary, since I was unable to feel the plank under my foot before having to commit to each drop. But I felt so amazing, I barely noticed. On a high from the cheers, the adrenaline and the satisfaction of shoving that chivalry back in my instructor's face, I faced down the next obstacle. Piece of cake. It was a large log, about 2 feet wide and horizontal, held up at both ends by wooden braces leveled at about shoulder height. To set up the obstacle, the instructors would roll the log a few inches toward the cadet. This way, when the cadet would run at, jump on, and swing their leg up over the log would begin rolling away from the cadet, so we could roll with the log to the other side. I volunteered to go first again, eager to keep my awesome streak alive. Running full steam ahead, I hit the log and threw my leg up. However, the instructor hadn't reset the obstacle, so instead of rolling with me, the log had rolled toward me. The smack of my knee on the log sounded like a mallet tenderizing a steak. The next smack was my back hitting the ground. I looked up at the beautiful sky, the same one I'd been enjoying from on high a moment ago, and an intense pain exploded up my leg and into my back. It was clear to everyone that I was badly hurt. I was instantly surrounded by my flight as the drill instructor pushed his way through the crowd to get to me. Then he called for assistance on his radio. My baggy cargo pants started to feel tight. The instructor, noticing the swelling, pulled a pocket knife out and cut my uniform right above my knee and gasped audibly. He keyed his mic again and upgraded his request to an ambulance. He began to gently unlace my boot, but the pain was intolerable, so he just cut the laces and removed my boot. As the paramedics loaded me into the ambulance, my instructor climbed in next to me. He knelt beside me and held my hand as the driver bumped along the uneven ground. I gritted my teeth, willing myself not to cry. I was in warrior mode, refusing to shed a tear. But then everything around me started to sort of sparkle. Darkness was creeping in at the edges, my vision shrinking to an ever smaller ring. The drill instructor began smacking the back of my hand, trying to get me to talk.
Hey, what's your name? Where are you from?
I felt like I was going to puke, but I managed to bark out, "Cadet Jennings, Austin, Texas, drill sergeant." He chuckled.
"You can turn it off, Jennings. You're going to be fine, but stay with me. You want to be a pilot, right?"
I was shocked. How did he know that? I guess pretty much all of us did.
"Yes, why?" "You do know that if you ever pass out and that gets on your record, you can't fly, right? So if you're hurting, just fucking scream and cry already. It's better than going unconscious."
It turns out that the collision between the log and my knee had succeeded in cracking my kneecap completely through. Luckily, it was still in one piece. You can't cast a broken joint, though, so I was just told to stay off of it. My mom and dad, who were picking me up from the airport, held hands and watched with pitying eyes as I was wheeled over to them in a wheelchair by the airline attendant. I had gone off to show everyone just how tough I was, but I couldn't even return home under my own power. I couldn't have known it then, but I would end up returning to officer training the following year and graduating in the top 10% of my class, but I'd have to complete the training with a knee injury that would plague me for the rest of my life. As I rolled down the airport walkway to the baggage claim in a wheelchair, my dad ruffled my hair.
"Aw, come on, sweetie. Don't look so sad. You're not invincible, you know. We still love you, darling."
My trademark hormonal teenage bad attitude always came out at the worst moments. Instead of letting myself be consoled, I refused to meet his eyes.
"A lot of good that'll do me," I growled.
For some reason I still can't quite understand, I was always pretty brutal to my stepfather. David was absolutely wonderful, and I did love him with all of my heart. But I made it a point to never admit that to him. Maybe I just wasn't ready to trust another father figure. As I grew older and realized I did want to tell him that I loved him, it had been built up so much that I wanted to wait for some kind of memorable occasion. I pictured him giving me away at my wedding, and before we walked down the aisle, I'd turn to him, kiss his cheek, and finally tell him I loved him. I pictured this scene more often than I care to admit. But later that fall, I'd have my last chance, and I'd miss it. On the night of October 5, 1997, I was at my parents' house doing laundry and mooching dinner like any good college student. It was my junior year in college, and by then I had mostly recovered from the broken kneecap. My knee would never be the same, but I was no longer in a lot of pain. After dinner, I helped clean up the kitchen, and we all started winding down for the night. Then David told me he had a gift for me, that I'd be getting my Christmas present early this year, which was very uncharacteristic of him. He handed me a box with a huge smile on his face.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.